looks so much cleaner. I mean, it's passable as a legit camera. Even if I go to like a totally outrageous color over here, you can see my skin is staying pretty much intact. But you can see this is the image where we started out with, and this is with everything turned on. Hey everyone, how's it going? Just want to say a huge thanks to all the recent love and support on my iPhone 12 Pro Max video. If you haven't already checked it out, make sure to click the card above or the links in the description if you want to wait till after this video, preferably. And today I just want to go through what exactly makes Dolby Vision footage so amazing. But how much better is it than the previous generations of iPhones and other camera footage? And how do all the different major NLEs work with it? So what I'm going to do is quickly jump into Adobe Premiere and Final Cut Pro, and we're going to see how Dolby Vision footage imports and how well it handles in those software. And then we're going to dive a little bit deeper in DaVinci Resolve, since Resolve by far is the best software for color grading, color correcting. So let's go ahead and jump right in. Let's start with Premiere. So Premiere here, I created a new project earlier as a test, but I'll just make another one. Dolby Vision test footage here. And then you don't get a ton of options while setting up. You can choose where your scratch discs and everything are going. But in terms of the actual project settings, the only color management tools we have here are HDR graphics. I saw in a recent update, I think about a month or two ago, they added better support for HDR footage. So if I just go ahead and do that, it's going to open a new project. Got a folder here with a bunch of footage, a shot. And then, of course, we just start dragging media into the sequence. And we can see that everything's pretty much dropping in perfectly here. So interestingly enough, and as you'll see in the other two software, when you drop it in, they pretty much all drop in overexposed. The data's still there. But here, it's actually coming in perfectly exposed, basically the same way that you see on the phone screen. Now, that's really cool. And at first, I was concerned that it was just converting it to a Rec. 709 file, because these are Rec. 2020 HDR Dolby Vision files. But when you actually go through and start making corrections and adjustments, even doing crazy different moves, you can see that it is not breaking too easily one way or the other. It's got a really nice wide color range. So now I'm going to jump over to Final Cut Pro. Again, these first two pieces of software, I'm not really diving into actually color grading the files. I just want to show you, if these are the software of your choice, how the software is handling it. And in Final Cut Pro here, this actually had the same issue where when you imported it, it looked way overexposed and you had to adjust for highlights. But actually just a couple days ago, they came out with a software update to better handle the Dolby Vision footage. And so now we can see everything is properly exposed in our preview pane over here and in our media bay. And if I go in and create a new project, you don't have a lot of color space options to mess with. Even if you go to custom, you pretty much only have these three options. So it doesn't look like you can output in Rec. 2020, maybe if you send it to compressor after you're done, but you are going to be working in a Rec. 709 timeline space. Now, when you drop it in, you'll notice how blown out the image actually is, but you get a pop-up now that basically says adding HDR clip to SDR project. Bright content will be clipped in the project to adjust the image brightness, apply color correction effect, or apply the HDR tools and mess with those. And it's really as simple as, again, just going into your color corrector, heading over to the exposure, grab the highlights, and bring those puppies down. And if you want to check your scopes, you can go Command 7, and you can see that all that data is still there. So if I reset it, you can see that, again, it's just pushing the highlights majorly, and as we bring them down, nothing is actually clipped. All that data is still there. Now, if I go to here, for example, grab this one, bring it all the way down. Now, any phone out there is going to clip when you shoot straight into the sun. So we can see in our image over here, the sun obviously is clipped, and we can see that represented over here in the graph. No matter how much I lower it, it is always going to be remained clipped, but everything else comes back And obviously you can go in and flatten it, and you can just do so much to this footage. It's kind of ridiculous. You also can go down here to the effects panel and go over to color, and then HDR tools. You can grab that. And then here defaults HDR to Rec 709, but it's still blown. So you can go to HLG to Rec 709, and that's going to set it up as well. Again, you could like save this as a color preset and just apply it to all your clips if you wanted to. All right, so now let's hop into DaVinci Resolve. And I am using version 17, which is currently out in beta. It was announced a couple days ago just because this has some new tools that are amazing. And once again, proves that DaVinci Resolve is pretty much the only option for anyone serious about color work. It kind of makes all the other software look like child's play. Okay, now in Resolve, you have way more options when it comes to your actual project setup. And so you can screenshot this or whatever you need to do. There's a handful of combinations for color spaces that I found to work pretty closely, but so far, this is the best one I've come up with. I've changed it in the past couple videos as I've played with it more. But I recommend changing the color science to the color manage version. It's going to default to the top one, but this is going to give you the extra controls. We're going to go HDR Rec 2020 for basically the input. That's what type of footage it's bringing into the timeline. And then it's going to output that timeline in a Rec 2020. And if we go and look at some of the footage I've already dropped in here, you can see that everything from an exposure standpoint is pretty good. It's a little hot in certain places, but mostly it's just kind of a little funky colors, a little desaturated, very much looks in the way that HDR footage looks kind of right off the bat before someone really goes in and color corrects it. So now let's head to the color page and see everything that we can do. We got some scopes off to the side here, but I'm going to bring my 4 up so we can see a bit more. And the first thing I want to point out is actually I shot just this clip a couple minutes ago, just of my face. And this is just me holding, this is the main sensor out of the Pro Max and just in the stock camera app, of course, for the Dolby Vision. And you can see that it's sharp on my face. Everything is well exposed. I haven't made any corrections yet. And you can see not blown any highlights. Shadows are all good. And you can see we even have some natural bokeh going on with the computer monitor being slightly out of focus because of the bigger sensor in that camera. Now here, I actually shot the same exact style of clip with my iPhone XS Max. And you can see right off the bat, the huge difference between these two. One, the computer screen is more in focus just because it's a smaller sensor. But more importantly than that, you can see how terribly overblown both the highlight part of the computer screen, as well as the splotchy, the basically harsh spots in my face here. And if we look over at the scopes, these solid lines means that that data is gone. So even if I lower it here all the way down, the remaining flat lines. And so that's not good because that's not really being recovered. I can go over here to the highlights and you can see it's going to try to pinch it, but then it just starts looking ugly really, really quickly. And yeah, you're not doing a whole lot to this image without it just completely breaking apart and becoming super ugly. Now again, if I go back to the Dolby Vision clip, here you can see I look almost like sick and green, but we can go in and pretty much quickly change that because again, we have all this data to work with. And I'm just gonna quickly go through and do a quick kind of color correction on this so you can see the difference. All right, so that looks pretty good to me. Everything is well within the scope still. And I basically went through and first made some basic exposure contrast corrections. Then I actually went in and highlighted my face and to do some skin tone adjustments. This with like the 8-bit footage would be near impossible. We'll see and test it out in a second to see how well it works. But this gives us a lot of data to select just the skin tone region. I could have gone even more and masked this out so it didn't get the computer monitor at all, but that's fine. And then I even applied a film LUT to it, which is something that can very easily break normal phone footage, and then I rounded it off with just a very slight vignette. Now, what I'm actually going to do here is grab a still, which for those of you who are not Resolve users, essentially captures everything that I did over here in the nodes. And I'm going to go back to this clip right here, and I'm just going to apply it, and it's going to do the same exact actions on this clip. And if this was another Dolby Vision clip shot in the same spot, it would relatively look the same. If I go back over to this skin tone mask, see how many holes in the splotchiness and pixel, and that shows you how much less color information is available for it to grab. We can see here that both the highlights and the shadows are crushed. Try and lift. I can lift some of the shadows back, but as we talked about before, highlights can come down a little bit, but we're still missing the data from those harsh spots here, and on the computer are completely gone. Not to mention my entire shirt here, totally gone. Even if I go to highlight control, it's really just dimming it. It's not bringing any information back. Going to the same spot, looks so much cleaner. You can tell my shirt is completely still, properly exposed, no harsh spots. And this, I mean, it's passable as a legit camera. I'm actually like super impressed and happy with how this is looking. All right, and next we're going to jump to this clip right here. Again, if we look at it from the scope's point of view, everything is well exposed. And so I'm going to show you a new tool in here. I'm going to do a basic correction first. All right, so I went through and made the correction and even add a little creative LUT on top of it, just add a little bit of style. And so we're going to check out this spiderweb looking thing called the Color Warper. This is brand new. This thing is awesome. So it's basically a tool to adjust the hue and saturation all at once. They also have a secondary tool that is Chroma versus Luma. If you want to know the difference, just hover your mouse over them. But for right now, we're primarily going to stick to hue versus saturation. What's really cool is if you hover your mouse over the image, you can see down here at the bottom on the Color Warper, it's basically picking what part of the image is that color. So for example, my windbreaker here has kind of a bluish tint to it. And so I can click on that and you can see down here in the Color Warper, it's added a red dot to basically save the zone. And essentially I'm going to drag. Now the further I drag out, I'm adding saturation back in. If I go to the center, I'm desaturating that specific color. So you can see the green and my skin tones are all staying the same. It's changing any of the surrounding colors here. So mainly the jacket, you can also see the sky is changing if I go more green. But even if I go to like a totally outrageous color over here, you can see my skin is staying pretty much completely intact. Now the other quicker way to do it is instead of clicking data point and dragging down here, can actually just click and drag and watch the Color Warper down here. So I'm going to click on my skin here and then you can see it sets the point, but now I'm going to keep holding and now I'm actually moving that point. So again, I can go towards the middle if I wanted to desaturate, towards the edge if I wanted to saturate, or just move it around to adjust both slightly here. Color Warper is a really cool added addition. Alrighty, and finally, I want to show you the biggest, coolest thing that they added in Resolve 17. So we all know the primary wheels here, but they've actually added a whole new set of six HDR color wheels here. So essentially what you have here is instead of shadows, midtones, and highlights, it breaks it down using the Ansel Adams method, and it breaks it down even more specific. So now we have black, dark, shadow, light, and then you have highlight and specular. My favorite part about the HDR tools is this little button above each of the color wheels. If you click and hold that button, it's actually showing you the parts of the image that will be affected by that color wheel. So this, everything you see in the image is the specular highlights. If I click on here, here's the highlights. And so I can go here and go, okay, specular highlights. I have my exposure settings, my saturation, and of course my normal color wheel. So I can go in here and I could lower my speculars, or I want them to pop off a bit, but not too high. I'm bringing them just under clipping, checking out my scopes here. And then I want to find kind of the mid-tone. So I'm going to go over to light. I think that's where most of it is. Yeah, so that's where most of the image kind of resides. I want to bring this down a bit. Now for my highlights, just to make it stand out, I'm going to actually raise those a bit, adding back in some contrast that I took away in the light section. You can see my shadows. So I want to keep those wheels looking nice and black. Now this image, I didn't need to mess with much of the actual color wheels changing the hues. And there's a ton of other tools, but again, the primary point in this video was to show you how flexible the Dolby Vision footage from the iPhone is. I mean, you can really go in here and I can really start to make a pretty dramatic look out of this. So if I wanted to kind of roll backwards here, let me pick something that's really stylized. Yeah, so this Fury one, for example, this is what I was talking about before, where someone would be like, oh, I want it to look like Blue Hour, so I'm just going to slap this Day for Night LUT on top of it and call it a day. And actually, I'm going to go through and see what we can do to correct this. All right, so I'm pretty happy with this. If I turn off all effects real quick, you can see this is the image where we started out with, and this is with everything turned on. Again, we were going for that like Blue Hour kind of dusk vibe, and so you can see that it still has a hint of blue. It's on the cooler side, but what I did was bring back the actual color of the car. I left some of the blue more touching the specular highlights. So the car itself is still maintaining all of the colors. So this is what it looks like if you literally just slap the LUT on the footage itself. And this is what it looks like when you actually go through and color correct it, bringing back the proper colors. And the fact that this 10-bit Dolby Vision footage from an iPhone was able to handle all of those corrections. But yeah, that's it for now, guys. Let me know down in the comments below what you think about this footage. I am by far impressed with what the Pro Max was able to do with the bigger sensor, and just the Dolby Vision footage itself is so flexible and awesome that way beyond anything I've seen in a phone so far. But yeah, thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next video.